Hello and welcome to the analysis of Civil Services Diagnostic Test 1. As we all know, CSAT paper consists of paper 1 and paper 2. Here we are going to discuss paper 2. 50% of this paper comprises of quantitative aptitude, analytical reasoning and deductive interpretation. And the other 50% consists of verbal ability and logical reasoning. Now we are going to discuss verbal ability and logical reasoning here. Now, under the section of verbal ability and logical reasoning, most of the questions, that is 70% of the paper, consists of reading comprehensions. Now, reading comprehensions, what are the topics that reading comprehensions are based on? Reading comprehensions are mostly from topics that they perceive that a person who is looking for a job in governance should be able to deal with. Like, for instance, the RC passages would be related to politics, they'd be related to banking, they can be related to social concerns, history, science and technology, and so on and so forth. Right. Now, there are in all 80 questions, and each of the questions carries equal marks. There is also some amount of negative marking. Here in this diagnostic test 1, the negative marking is 1/3 of the marks. The time allotted to the paper is 2 hours and maximum marks is 200. And now let's look at the first passage that follows. The first passage, how to deal with this RC passage is of our concern. First of all, we'll look at the passage, we'll skim and scan through it. First of all, we can see keywords like humankind, antibiotics, Alexander Fleming, then superbugs, then antimicrobial resistance, World Health Organization. So clearly it's got to do with health and disease and spread of disease, etc., etc. So before we look at the passage, we should go through the questions that follow, because that's going to help us focus on specific areas in the passage. If we just read the question stems before we go through the passage. So the first question comprises of 4 options. And then followed by a question, which is, which of the given options are factors that have caused the chorus of concern mentioned in the passage, right? So it talks about pathogens, antibiotics, superbugs. So we're going to see what all is the concern that the passage refers to. Second question consists of a question on Alexander Fleming, then antimicrobial resistance, then World Health Organization. Third question asks you the meaning of bad old days in accordance with the passage. And so clearly you know you're supposed to focus on this particular phrase when it comes. And so as we can see that the passage is followed by 3 questions in all. Now let's go through the passage. The passage talks about for too long, humankind has taken for granted the antibiotics that have held dangerous germs at bay. So what is the concern? First line is the most important line in the passage. What has it done? Humankind has taken for granted the antibiotics that have held dangerous germs at bay. So clearly, antibiotics were taken for granted, so as a consequence of which something negative might have happened, and that has then become the chorus of concern. So when, as an active reader, I'm supposed to focus on not only what is given in the passage, but also kind of at the same time keep assuming what's to come next. So clearly it gives me the idea that the passage is about something that has happened to humankind that has become a major matter of concern as a consequence of taking antibiotics for granted, right? Now, it was only about 70 years ago that penicillin, the world's first antibiotic, came into widespread use and revolutionized medicine. Its discoverer, Alexander Fleming, who won the Nobel Prize for his work, recently warned the disease-causing organisms would become resistant if the drug was improperly used. So, he warned people against improper usage of the word. And Alexander Fleming won the Nobel Prize. He won it for discovering the first antibiotic, that is penicillin. And then So these are the keywords you're supposed to discuss. These are the keywords that you need to focus, right? What all the passage talks about. And that is just what has transpired. Now this is what comes from the very first line, taking for granted, taking antibiotics for granted. Although more antibiotics were subsequently discovered, these drugs have been given with such profligacy, have been dispensed so in so much excess that pathogens resistant to them have evolved and spread with alarming rapidity. Superbugs resistant to almost all antibiotics have become a problem. Now, as a consequence of this profligacy, what has happened? Pathogens have become resistant to them, and they have also evolved with alarming rapidity. Now, these pathogens are superbugs resistant to almost all antibiotics have become a problem, raising worries of a return to the bad old days. What would be these bad old days? The old days, the days when antibiotics had not been discovered and there was nothing to keep dangerous germs at bay, because much greater care was not exercised when prescribing existing drugs and sufficient encouragement for finding new ones was lacking. Now, with its first global report on antimicrobial resistance, the World Health Organization has added its voice to the chorus of concern. Now, since as we saw the first question, it deals with this word chorus of concern. So what is the chorus of concern? So definitely the chorus of concern will be these pathogens that have become resistant to almost all antibiotics, that is superbugs, and that have evolved to and that has spread to alarming rapidity, right? Now let's read these options given here. Pathogens resistant to almost all antibiotics. So clearly this is the answer. Yes, this is a major matter of concern. That is a part of the chorus of concern of WHO. Superbugs that constantly evolve. Superbugs definitely are a chorus of concern, but not those that constantly evolve. Pathogens evolved to become superbugs, that is pathogens resistant to almost all antibiotics, but whether they constantly evolve or not is an incorrect information. Rapid spread of some pathogens, so clearly the passage does mention that pathogens are the chorus of concern is pathogens and their spread with alarming rapidity. So this is also correct. Improper usage of antibiotics. So this definitely is the reason for this matter of concern to have arisen. So definitely this is also going to be a part of the chorus of concern, because these are the antibiotics that have been profligately dispensed, that is dispensed or given to people in excess. So clearly the answer to this question is 1, 3 and 4, that is option A. Right? Yes, definitely option A. Now the second question is, which of the following statements is correct according to the passage? Alexander Fleming warned against lack of research in the future. No, this is incorrect information. What Alexander Fleming warned against is improper usage of these antibiotics. Alexander Fleming won a Nobel Prize, yes. The first global report on antimicrobial resistance added voice to the chorus of concern. Is incorrect because it was WHO's first global report on antimicrobial resistance and not any global report. So therefore, this is also incorrect. World Health Organization's topmost concern is antimicrobial resistance. We do not know if it is the topmost concern. Definitely, it's a matter of concern, but not topmost. We do not know if it is a topmost one or not. Right? So definitely, the answer to this question is option B. The third question is, which of the following statement refers to the bad old days? Since we had already read the question, we were able to spot what bad old days meant in the passage. So, as we know, bad old days refers to the time when there were no antibiotics to keep, dangerous pathogens at bay. The time and sufficient encouragement for finding new antibiotics was lacking? No. The time when drugs that could control disease-causing organisms were not available. Yes, this is the answer. Third, it says the time when existing drugs were prescribed in careless manner. No, the existing drugs were prescribed in careless manner after the antibiotics had been discovered. So definitely bad old days won't refer to them. Bad old days would be a situation of miserable time when none of the disease-causing organisms could be kept at bay, could be controlled by use of drugs. So the answer to this question is only 2, that is option. Now, as we know, 50% of the paper more than 70% of VA and LR section consists of RC passages, and there are questions on critical reasoning also, and then there are questions on logical consistency. So let's go through one of the questions on critical reasoning. That's question number question number 7, which is, newlywed Samina attended an art exhibition showcasing before we read the passage, let's read the question. It says we're supposed to find out a conclusion that logically follows from the information given above. So we're supposed to find a conclusion of this. Newlywed Samina attended an art exhibition showcasing Lambeth's rarest paintings in Paris last week. From there, she went to an imitation art dealer's office and finished her tour with a visit to a sculptor. This week, she's going to a flea market to buy a miniature piano made of mahogany wood, a porcelain tea set, and a leather sofa, among other items. Now, she's attended an exhibition first, then she goes to the art dealer's office, and finally, she's planning to go to the flea market. So, definitely, in all the three cases, she's going to buy some products, some goods, right? And now, the conclusions are, Samina has plans of spending some time at the flea market. Yes, definitely, she has plans of going to a flea market, and then, therefore, she is going to spend some time there. A follows. Let's look at the other options. B says, Samina has a penchant for collecting strange items. Now, whether the items she collects are strange or not cannot be determined, because it's a rarest painting, but strange painting, we do not know. And she goes to the art dealer's office and finishes her tour with the visit to the sculptor. Here, she does not buy any strange thing. Then she's going to go to the flea market and buy a miniature piano made of mahogany wood, a porcelain tea set, and a leather sofa, among other items. So we cannot also conclude that these items, that she's going to buy at the flea market, are strange. So this also renders this option incorrect. He says, Samina is searching for stuff to decorate her new house. The reason for her visits is not given. So this is also incorrect. Samina is a spendthrift. She may not be a spendthrift. That's very judgmental. So therefore, option D is also incorrect. The correct answer to this question is option A. Now, next question is, there is only one rule to dealing with questions on critical reasoning. One, go through the question, go through the passage, and then find out the right answer by process of elimination, right? Now, eighth question is based on logical consistency. Now, let's read the given options here and then find out which of the following inferences can be drawn from the statements given above, okay? Now, first statement is, all artificial satellites use solar energy, right? Now, solar energy is a renewable source of energy, is one of the many renewable sources of energy. Solar energy is freely available. This is the fourth subject discussed. Wind is also a renewable source of energy. This is the fifth thing discussed. Right. Now, inferences drawn are, artificial satellites can run on any renewable source of energy. It says that solar energy is a renewable source of energy. Now, but whether artificial satellites can run on any renewable source of energy cannot be drawn, because it can run on solar energy. Only this information is given to us, not any other information. B says no costs are involved. This renders option A incorrect. No costs are involved in functioning of artificial satellites. Now, we know that artificial satellites run on solar energy, but we are not given whether they only run on solar energy. It is quite possible that artificial satellites also require some other kind of energy that is not freely available, unlike solar energy. So we cannot say that no costs are involved in the functioning of artificial satellites. So this is also incorrect. C says some of the energy used by artificial satellites is freely available. Yeah. Definitely, some of the energy would be solar energy that is used in artificial satellites is freely available. This is correct. D says wind is freely available. We do not know. The only information given here is that wind is a renewable source of energy. Whether it is freely available or not cannot be said. So, this is also incorrect. The correct answer to this question is option C. Now, let's deal with another passage to brush up our technique of RC. let's go to this passage on Bhopal gas tragedy, which is passage 2. It says, when the Bhopal gas disaster revealed itself in all its horror. So clearly it deals with Bhopal gas tragedy, its horror, and it happened in Madhya Pradesh, and then it caused really much acute suffering. It talks about acute suffering, central government's role, survivors. So Warren Anderson, UCC chairman, UCC's Union Carbide Corporation. Okay, so then it goes about explaining protecting survivors in place of protecting survivors from ambulance chasing lawyers. So clearly it deals with Bhopal gas tragedy, so its survivors, justice, suffering, role of central government. Then it has got something to do with Warren Anderson also, who is the Union Carbide Corporation's chairman. And then the role of government, the role played by government, right? Now let's go to the question stems. It says, with reference to the passage, consider the following statements. And then we have to find out which of the following statements is correct. Okay, this is deals with national catastrophe, Warren Anderson. Government was insensitive to the victims of Bhopal gas disaster. Right. Next is, how did the government of India react to the catastrophic situation? So, reaction of government of India. Next, what makes the author say that government robbed the victims of legal justice? So, this is also one of the reactions, one of the actions of government of India. So, once we've seen through the questions as victims, which of the following is true of the victims of the tragedy? Okay. Now, clearly, the passage, as from the questions also we can infer that the passage deals with Bhopal gas tragedy, what the victims had to suffer, how they had to deal with the situation, and the role of the government, right? Now, let's read the passage. Now that we know about the framework of the passage already, without even having read it, we're in a better position to answer questions. So, once we go through the passage, we're supposed to find out what all are the main ideas discussed in the passage. When the Bhopal gas disaster revealed itself in all its horror, with 3,000 early deaths and grave chemical injuries to tens of thousands of people, it was widely expected the government of India would treat it as a national catastrophe and mobilize all its resources to provide emergency relief to the survivors and secure justice for them. The very opposite happened. So this is the main idea of the passage. What was the government's reaction? It was the very opposite happened. Instead of launching a national level medical treatment program with the best available professional help, what did it do? It must have done the very opposite of it. That is, probably it could have gone insensitive or gone against the people, which could have saved hundreds of lives and relieved much acute suffering. The central government left the victims to the mercy of Madhya Pradesh government's pitiable healthcare infrastructure, in effect, handing them over to quacks. In place of putting on trials, it has been insensitive to the people. In place of putting on trial the directors of Union Carbide Corporation, now the reaction of the government towards the people, insensitive, now towards the people who were responsible, who were probably responsible for it and were supposed to be put to trial. Now what's the government's reaction towards them? In place of putting on trial the directors of Union Carbide Corporation of the United States and its Indian subsidiary, the government secretary, UCC chairman Warren Anderson, who had been arrested in Bhopal. What more? In place of protecting survivors from ambulance chasing lawyers who descended upon Bhopal, the government became a mute spectator to the theft of valuable medical evidence from the victims. So, the victims, they were manipulated by these ambulance chasing lawyers that had come from Bhopal. The government was supposed to protect these victims from protect the medical evidence of these victims from these lawyers, but it did not do so. This was only the prelude to a long systematic campaign to rob the victims of their right to justice and impose a terrible settlement upon them, which would compensate most of them with ₹25,000 for a lifetime of suffering through damage of their lungs, liver, kidneys, and immune system. So the author believes that the compensation given to the victims was a bare minimum, ₹25,000. So unjust an amount for the suffering that they had suffered. And this was all of the fault of the government, which did not do anything to stop these ambulance-chasing lawyers from making a theft of valuable medical evidence from the victims. Even as people were dying in Bhopal in the first week of December 1984, Indian diplomats were at pains to tell the world that the disaster would in no way affect India's foreign investment policies. So the Indian diplomats also did not change anything about its about India's foreign investment policy despite such a big catastrophe having taken place. So what is the main idea discussed in the passage? What happened as a consequence of Bhopal gas disaster? How did the government react towards the victim? How did it react towards Union Carbide corporations, people and chairman? And what did it actually do? And what was Indian diplomats' reaction to the disaster, to such a big disaster that had happened, that had occurred to the country? Now, the first question is, with reference to the passage, consider the following statements. A national catastrophe does not necessarily occur across the whole country. The passage clearly calls Bhopal gas tragedy as a national catastrophe, and definitely did not occur across the whole country. So therefore, one is correct. Two is, Warren Anderson was responsible for the Bhopal gas disaster. This is nowhere mentioned in the passage. It only says that Warren Anderson was arrested and he was set free by the government without having gone through the trial, which was unfair. Whether he was responsible or not, that was supposed to be the result that the government was, that the court was going to have decided. Okay, so that's not given in the passage and therefore is incorrect. Third says, the government was insensitive to the victims of Bhopal gas disaster. Clearly, the way the government behaved was insensitive. And therefore, the answer to this question is 1 and 3, that is option C. Now, let's go through this another passage in order to brush up our skills on of doing an RC passage. So, it deals with labor, it deals with capitalism, it deals with estrangement, it deals with transformation of nature. It deals with this is what the passage deals with mostly. According to the passage, the worker is estranged from the products which he creates. So let's go through these questions first and try to understand what it means. The worker is estranged from what all is the worker estranged from? So once I read this passage, I'm supposed to focus on this idea, the estrangement of the worker from the following, right? And the next question is, what is the crux of the passage? Once I read this passage, this is a theme-based passage. I'd be able to answer this question only once I've read the entire passage. Now, the next question is, with reference to the passage, consider the following statements. These are the two questions and we have to find out, these are two statements and we're supposed to find out which of the following statements is, which of the above statements is correct. Next question is, which of the following is not amongst the factors that would play a role in the overthrow of capitalism? So passage deals with also the overthrow of capitalism, and there will be certain factors that will be responsible for that overthrow. So when I'm reading the passage, I'm supposed to focus on that. So this is what reading the question stem helps us do. First of all, we've got to know that the passage is followed by four questions. We get to know about the main idea of the passage. That is, get a fair idea about what the passage is about and what we're supposed to focus on. Because definitely we have a paucity of time and we can't focus on anything and everything. Right, now let's read the passage. It says, labor is as much an act of personal creation and a projection of one's identity as a means of survival. As an active reader, from this I can conclude that the passage will deal with what a laborer, what is it about capitalism that makes a laborer get estranged from, his identity. That is an act of personal creation and a projection of one's identity and as a means of survival. Not only is it a means of survival, but also a projection of one's identity. It's a process of personal creation, right? However, capitalism, the system of private ownership of the means of production, deprives human beings of this essential source of self-worth and identity. The worker approaches work as only a means of survival and derives none of the other personal satisfactions of work because the products of labor do not belong to him. Okay, now who is the perpetrator? The perpetrator of a laborer is capitalism. Why? Why is it, what is it that estranges him from essential source of self-worth and identity? Is because the product that he creates, the products of his labor do not belong to him. These products are instead taken by the capitalism and sold for profit. Now, in capitalism, worker who is alienated or estranged from the products he creates is also estranged from the process of production. So now this is further estrangement. Alienation from the products leads to alienation from the process of production. But since we know that we've already read the question, so we know what to focus on. What all is the worker estranged from? He's estranged from the products of his labor. He's estranged from the process of production, which he regards only as a means of survival. Estranged from the production process, the worker is therefore also estranged from his or her own humanity. Since the transformation of nature into useful objects is one of the fundamental facets of human condition, the worker is thus alienated from, there's more to alienation and estrangement. The worker is thus alienated from his or her species, his or her species being, from what it is to be human. Finally, the capitalist mode of production alienates human beings from other human beings. A worker is also alienated from other human beings, deprived of the satisfaction that comes with owning the product of one's own labor. The worker regards a capitalist as an external and hostile. So he is also estranged from the capitalist. He's regarded as external and hostile. The alienation of the worker from his work and the worker from the capitalists forms the basis of the hostile social relationship that will eventually lead to the overthrow of capitalism. From the last question is based on the overthrow of capitalism. The reason being, what are the factors that lead to this overthrow of capitalism? It'd be estrangement, hostility between worker and capitalism, worker, and then hostile social relationship, and then worker from his work. So all these reasons, this is the note on which the passage concludes. Estrangement of the worker from, now what is the main theme? The main theme of the passage is labor does not get, is not satisfied because the work he does not give him does not satisfy him. It does not serve as a means for self-identity. All that it does is it estranges him from the product of his work. As a result, process of production, it estranges him from other human beings. It estranges him from the capitalist. And finally, this estrangement can lead to the overthrow of capitalism, right? So this is mostly what the passage basically deals with. Right. Now let's read the question that follows. The first question says, according to the passage, the worker is estranged from which of the following? The product which he creates, definitely yes. The process of production, yes. This is the second estrangement that the passage talks about. His own humanity, yes. Other human beings, yes. The capitalist, yes. So since all of them are correct, so the answer to this question is option D. Next question says, what is the crux of the passage? Alienation of the worker from the products of his labor, or the process of production and other human beings, which includes the capitalist. Yes, this is correct. Let's look at the other options. The worker approaches work as a means of personal satisfaction because the products of his labor are used by capitalists and they benefit from those products. The first line itself is incorrect. It's not a means of personal satisfaction at all. The worker is estranged from his family. The passage talks gives no reference to estrangement of the worker from his family. As long as a worker's basic needs and social requirements are fulfilled, the worker stays satisfied. Against what the passage talks about. So clearly, the answer to this question is option A. Next question. With reference to the passage, consider the following statements. The first question is, because the worker is estranged from the product which he creates, he is also estranged from his own humanity, as a conversion of nature into objects is an important facet of human condition. Yeah, this can be inferred from this particular statement in the passage, which says that, you know, here, estranged from the production process, the worker is therefore also estranged from his or her own humanity. Why? Since the transformation of nature into useful objects is one of the fundamental facets of the human condition. Right? So, this is what concludes. This can also be rephrased as, the worker is estranged from the product which he creates, he is also estranged from humanity, as conversion of nature into objects is an important facet of the human condition. The second says, in the capitalist mode of production, products of labor are seized by the capitalist. Yes, they're taken away by the capitalist, sold for profits. And the worker creates them as a means of his survival and not as a manifestation of his self-worth. Yeah, creation of product for the worker is only a means of survival. This is also correct statement. correct phrase, and not a manifestation of his self-worth, yet definitely does not give him kind of satisfaction that his self-worth is being manifested. So this is also correct. The answer to this question is option C. Which of the following is not amongst the factors that would play a role in the overthrow of capitalism? Now we have to find out which of them is not the one that that will play a role in overthrow of capitalism. Deprivation of worker from the products of his labor. Yes, definitely it is going to play a role, because this is the main thing that triggers the idea, that triggers the overthrow. When, because the worker is away from this product, it leads to estrangement from everything else, including the capitalist, which can lead to overthrow of capitalism. B says a projection of one's identity is more important than means of survival. This is factually incorrect, because we do not know which of them is more important from the other. So therefore, this cannot be a factor. Therefore, this is the correct answer. Hostility towards capitalists, this also does play a role, and therefore the answer to this question is option B. Now let's move on to discuss the next kind of the next type of question, which is decision making. Although in 2014 we did not have any such kind of questions appearing in the paper, but since 2013 there had always been five to eight question in every paper on decision making. Now therefore it's important for us to discuss decision making questions here, and let's move to the questions. Now before dealing with a decision making question, we should keep in mind that a decision making question, first of all, should not have any such option for an answer that is unethical, that is absolutely against the rule. Unethical answer is a total no-no. You cannot select that, and then we have to take care that the solution given is not extreme. It has to be just apt, the best of all the options given for this particular case in hand. Okay, now for example, let's read this particular question here on the screen. It says, you are the head of a government office and have a neat and clean reputation. Your department regularly issues ads and public interest notices. These ads and notices appear in the top vernacular newspapers in your district. The editor of a vernacular newspaper with small circulation has made an allegation against you through an article in his newspaper. He has insinuated that you give ads and notices issued by your department to select newspapers in return for monetary favors. What will your response be to this allegation? Okay, now the options say, give some ads to his newspaper so that he stops attacking you without reason. Now you know that you are right. Why would you give him a few ads to keep his mouth shut? If you're trying to do that, definitely it's somewhere in your heart you believe you want to shut him up, right? That's not your focus. So therefore this option is completely unethical and not the answer. Okay, option B is, call a press conference and take an oath on the religious book stating that you are innocent and that the gods will punish the editor for his impertinence in accusing you. This is kind of ridiculous. You don't do this in press conferences. And also, on the other hand, a press conference is an extreme step, because first you will definitely be angered, and you have to file a case instead against the editor. So clearly option D appears to be the best answer. File a defamation case against the editor, because that's what the editor has done, which is completely unasked for. And the best response that you can give is right now file a case against the editor, right? Now this is the best answer. Now since we are also supposed to find the second best answer, we should choose option C, because it's less ridiculous. It says, call a press conference condemning the false allegations and explain the process of deciding which newspaper to allocate ads and notices to, and it also clarifies your position. You know, this is the newspaper I allocate ads to, and this is the reason why, and you take away the blame by clearly condemning that particular newspaper for having hurled false accusations against you. So C is the second best answer, D is the best, and C is the second best. So this is how you decide. this is how you deal with a decision making question. Now, all the best for the rest of the tests your way, and thank you. So was the analysis. Thank you. I hope you liked it.
Here it is given that Fali Ram, who is a fruit vendor, had apples and mangoes in ratio 2:3. And it is also given that he sold all the fruits at rupees 24 per piece and made a profit of 20%, and the cost price of one apple is rupees 20. Then we have to find the cost price of each mango. Let the total number of apple that Fali Ram had be 2A and that of mangoes 3A, and the total says that he generated through the sales of these fruits will be 2A plus 3A into 24, as he sold all the fruits at 24, and this is 20% more than, which means 1.2 times of 2A into 20, as price of each apple is rupees 20, and 3A into the price of each mango, suppose it is X. On solving this, we get X equals rupees 20. It means the price of each mango is rupees 20, which is option A. And one more thing can be noted here: as each of apple as well as mangoes is sold at the same price, which is 24, and it earns a profit of 20%, and it is also known that 20% of 20 is 4. It means if one wants to earn a profit of 20% on 20, he or she has to sell that item at a price of 24. And here it is given that price of each apple is 24. So if I want to earn a profit of same amount, that is of rupees 4 on each mango, then cost price of mango should also be the same, that is 20. So this is also one of the ways to solve this problem, that is a bit easier, simpler than going through equation and all. So that's all for this question. In this problem, it is known that the interest accrued on a sum invested at 10.25% simple interest for 4 years is 4510. As interest is for 4 years and rate is 10.25%, which means the total interest accrued is nothing but 10.25 into 4, that is 41% of principal. So from here we can find the principal, and it will be 4510 into 100 upon 41. It comes out to be 11,000. Now it is asking what would have been the total amount had this same amount been invested at 4% compound interest compounded annually. So we have amount here, which is 11,000, and we have to find the total amount, that is amount plus interest, for 2 years with interest. So amount will be 11,000 into 1.04, that is with 4% interest at the end of first year, and again we have to calculate the 4% interest for the next year. Then amount at the end of second year will be 11,000 into 1.04 into 1.04. It comes out to be 11,000 897.60. One more thing can be noted here, and it is the rightmost non-zero digit of each of the given four options is different, and from here it can be noted that it has to be 6, because non-zero digit of the principal is 1 from right hand side, and that of 1.04 and 1.04 is 4 each. So last digit or non-zero digit of this number will be last digit of 1 into 4 into 4, which comes out to be 6. So through this we can see option A is the correct answer without even computing the figure. So that's all for this question. Here we have two machine M1 and M2 that produce bolts. The number of bolts produced by M1 in a day is 240 with 12 defective bolts, and that of by M2 is 160 with 8 defectives. Here it is also given that at the end of the day, if a bolt from among the bolts produced on that day is picked up randomly and found to be defective, so total number of defective bolts here is 12 plus 8, that is 20. And it is known that the bolt picked up is defective, so it has to be out of these 20 bolts. Here it is asking what is the probability that it was produced by machine M2. So the total number of cases or sample number of elements in sample space is 20, and it is asking what is the probability that the bolt chosen or picked up is from M2. M2 uses 8 defective bolts, and the total number of defective bolts produced in a day is 20. So our answer has to be 8/20, that is 0.4. therefore option C is the correct answer. Here it is given that the cost of 5 apples, let the price of each apple be A, and that of each banana be B, and that of a mango be M. So the price of 5 apples, 6 bananas and 8 mangoes is given as 60, and that of 10 apple, 9 bananas and 7 mangoes is given as 90. And here we have to find the price of 2 apple, 2 banana and 2 mangoes. If we observe these two equations, we can see that if we add these two equations, we'll find the same coefficient with each of the variables, that is A, B and C or M. So on adding, we find that 15A plus 15B plus 15M equals 150. From here we get A plus B plus M as 10, and we have to find twice of A plus twice of B plus twice of M. It means we don't need to do anything but to multiply this equation by 2. From here we get twice of A plus twice of B plus twice of M as 20. Therefore the required answer is 20, which is option B. In this problem, ABC is a right angle triangle in which angle B is 90, and D and E are midpoints of AB and BC respectively. This is D and this is E. It is also given that AB is 6 and AC is 10. using Pythagoras theorem, we can find value of BC. It comes out to be 8. And here we have to find in radius of the triangle DBE, join DB as D is the midpoint of AB, which means DB is 3 and BE will be 4, since E is the midpoint of BC. From here we can find value of DE again using the Pythagoras theorem. It comes out to be 5. Now we have to find in radius of triangle BDE, whose sides are 3, 4, 5. In radius is given by delta upon S, where delta is the area of triangle, which will be 1 by 2 into base into height. Base is 4 and height is 3, and S, which is the semi perimeter, perimeter of this triangle is 3 plus 4 plus 5, which is 12. Semi, that is half of this quantity, 6, from where we get R as 1. So required answer is option B. In this set, the table given shows marks is obtained by 5 students, Ali, Bilal, Singh, Daljeet and Angel, across 5 subjects: physics, chemistry, math, history and economics. From the table we can see the marks obtained by Ali in physics as 42, by Cheng in maths 43. Similarly, we can find the marks obtained by other students in the given 5 subjects. Now coming to the first question of this set, here it is asking in which subject was the average marks of 5 students the highest. So basically we have to find the total marks of 5 students in each of the 5 subjects and then divide each of these figures by 5 and check which figure is the highest. Rather than doing the same for each of the 5 subjects, we need to observe which could be the probable subjects in which the average marks of 5 students could be the highest. On a closer look at the table, we can say that these subjects could be either physics or chemistry. On checking, we find the total marks in physics is 200 and that in chemistry is 180. So the physics is the subjects in which average marks of the 5 students put together will be the least. Now coming to the next question of this set, here it is asking who is the student whose average marks in the 5 subjects was the lowest. Again we had to find the average, but this time around we have to find the average of marks of each student across the 5 subjects. So we have to follow the same procedure, and this time we have to find the sum of marks of each student across the 5 subjects and then divide those figure by 5 to get their average. And on doing the same, we find the average for Daljeet as 41, for Ali as 31.8, Bilal 27, Cheng 39.6 and Angel as 29.6. Therefore, Bilal is the person whose average marks across the five subjects is the least. Now coming to the last question of this set, here we have to check the median score of the students in physics was how much more or less than that in maths. Median of certain observation is the middlemost figure out of the given observations. Here it could be seen that for physics the middlemost marks is 42 and that for maths is 32. So the required difference will be 42 minus 32, that is 10. Therefore option B is the correct answer. In this problem, three married couples H1W1, S2W2 and S3W3 are to be seated around a circular table such that each person is sitting diametrically opposite to his or her spouse. It is also known that H1 and S3 are sitting adjacent to each other and we have to find the number of distinct possible arrangements. So let's draw a figure. Here it is known that H1 and S3 are adjacent to each other, so there are two possibilities. First one is this and second one would be S3 and H1. As we know that each person is sitting diametrically opposite to his or her spouse, so from here W1 will sit opposite to H1 and W3 will sit opposite to S3. Now there are two vacant places and the remaining pair can sit in two ways, like this position can be occupied by H1 or W1. Similarly, this will be occupied by W or S2. So in each of the cases, there are two possible cases. Therefore, the total number of ways in which they can sit around the circular table is 2 plus 2, that is 4. And it is given in option D. In this grid, numbers are correlated in certain way and we have to find the number that should come at the place of question mark. Here if we add digit of 15, that is the first element of the leftmost cell of first row, and we multiply this by 3 plus 1, this comes out to be 6 into 4, which is 24. And when we add the digits of 24, we get 6. This, which is the number in middle cell of this row. Similarly, we can check whether this holds for the next row or not. On checking, we find 2 plus 1 into 2 plus 4, 3 into 5, this comes out to be 3 into 6, this comes out to be 18. Again, sum of digits of 18 is 9. So this is the logic what is there, and using the same logic we can find what should come at the place of question mark. It will be 3 into 1, 3 plus 1 into 3 plus 3 equals 4 into 6, which is 24, and it comes out to be 6. Therefore option B is the correct answer. In this problem there are 4 figures in question figures and there are 4 figures in option figures, and we have to identify the pattern among question figures, and accordingly we have to decide what will come next after the given four question figures. If we observe closely, we could see that in each of the subsequent figure there is one more extra line compared to that of the previous figure. So on this basis we can say that the number of lines that should come excluding the curve in the next figure should be 6, which is only in option C. And when it comes to getting the pattern of numbers in each figure, we could see 3 is 2 square minus 1, 10 is 3 square plus 1, 15 is 4 square minus 1, 26 is 5 square plus 1. So next figure should be 6 square minus 1, that is 35. So option C is the correct answer.